Welcome to How Gear Changed the Game, an exploration of the evolution of sports and the role that sporting goods equipment, gear, has in that evolution. We've been talking about the football helmet and its role in the changes of the game of football throughout the years. In our previous episode, Football Helmets, Tonight in the Tee, we talked about the emergence of the plastic helmet, the invention of it, the plastic it's made out of, which, yeah, you guessed it, is called Tonight. We talked about John T. Riddell and his connections to George Halas, Clark Shaughnessy, and Northwestern. Northwestern was one of the first football teams to wear the plastic helmet in 1940, and Clark Shaughnessy and George Halas were developing the T formation and also had some involvement and some use when it came to the plastic helmet. The success of the plastic helmet and a modern style of play that demands the protection it provides made this new plastic helmet ready to start flying off the shelves. But supplies would be cut off. America was headed to war, and this new football helmet would be called to duty. Before we go any further, just know this episode builds upon knowledge we gained in the previous two episodes, Genesis and Tonight and the T. If you haven't heard those two episodes, you might end up a little bit lost, and I really, really recommend you listen to those before listening to this one. On June 5th, 1943, U.S. soldiers, most of whom had never seen combat, were putting on their helmets that contained the web suspension made by the Riddell Company. That was part of the gear they were preparing for their invasion the following day. And as they prepared that gear, they listened to an address from one of the star players of the 1912 Army football team. This is what they heard.
Soldiers, sailors, and airmen of the Allied Expeditionary Force, you are about to embark upon the great crusade toward which we have striven these many months. The eyes of the world are upon you. The hopes and prayers of liberty-loving people everywhere march with you. In company with our brave allies and brothers in arms on other fronts, you will bring about the destruction of the German war machine, the elimination of Nazi tyranny over the oppressed peoples of Europe, and security for ourselves in a free world. Your task will not be an easy one. Your enemy is well-trained, well-equipped, and battle-hardened. He will fight savagely. But this is the year 1944. Much has happened since the Nazi triumphs of 1940-41. The United Nations have inflicted upon the Germans great defeats in open battle, man to man. Our air offensive has seriously reduced their strength in the air and their capacity to wage war on the ground. Our home front have given us an overwhelming superiority in weapons and munitions of war and placed at our disposal great reserves of trained fighting men. The tide has turned. The free men of the world are marching together to victory. I have full confidence in your courage, devotion to duty, and skill in battle. We will accept nothing less than full victory. Good luck, and let us all beseech the blessing of Almighty God upon this great and noble undertaking.
When he talks about the efforts on the home front, it was an all-in effort from everyone. Factories would retool their equipment to make things needed for the war, for our troops. And one company making a pivot was the Riddell Company. Many military leaders, including General George Patton, had seen this Riddell helmet and wanted it to be outfitted for battle. It's an ongoing theme, football borrowing from war, war borrowing from football. And in this case, the football helmet would go to war and then return home to yellow ribbon treatment. Let's learn all about it on this episode of How Gear Changed the Game. In the fall of 1941, an article by the United Press started to circulate in newspapers across the country, writing about a chance encounter between an Army officer and the plastic helmet. It goes like this, quote, "Army parachute jumpers will soon know how a Northwestern University fullback feels when he lands on his head. The Army has adopted the Martian-looking headgear, which the Northwestern football team introduced last fall. Parachute troops training in Fort Benning, Georgia have started to use them. Made of a tough plastic called Tenite, the helmet has proved lighter than the old leather headpiece and more durable. It also provides the wearer with greater ventilation. The new headgear is an invention of John T. Riddell, former Evanston High School coach who went into business in 1927 when his idea for a football shoe with detachable cleats proved profitable. Riddell had the helmet on display in a Georgia sporting goods house when an Army parachute troop officer noticed it. Attracted by the headbands, which kept the helmet off the head of the wearer, the officer decided that with a few alterations, it could make the ideal parachute helmet. The ear guards were shortened and the leather curtains were attached at the front and rear, adapting the headgear to the parachutist's purpose. End quote. So that simple chance encounter ended up making all the difference in World War II when it came to the helmet. The World War I helmet, known as the Doughboy, the M1917 model, was completely outdated and needed replacing. And this helmet, found sitting in a window at a sporting goods store in Fort Benning, Georgia, would be the helmet of the future. And General George Patton was also looking for a redesign of the helmet. He was trying to revamp the way tanks were done, and that included the uniforms and protection of those working inside tanks. And when he presented a design of the new uniform that tank personnel would be wearing, a plastic helmet was part of it. Apparently, according to some records, he was even involved in talking to Riddell and the Riddell Company directly in order to get these helmets modified for usage in working a tank. So look at that. Tanks and football helmets are a two-way street. A little bit ago, we were talking about the tank tactics that Shaughnessy was using with a new football helmet. And now new football helmets are going to be used in tanks. With some modifications, of course. But those new football helmets are now going to go against that panzer general that Shaughnessy was borrowing his plays from. Spoiler alert, the good guys win. So the helmet had gone from helping a couple of successful seasons happen with Stanford and Northwestern to now helping America win a war. But not right away. That article that I just quoted, that came out in October of 1941. 2 months later, a strategic bombing campaign carried out by the Japanese at Pearl Harbor would send the U.S. into the war. And the helmet would be donned on every soldier hitting the soil in North Africa, Europe, and the South Pacific. Riddell's plastic helmet went from the football field to the battlefield by way of three different variations on the original design. The paratrooper helmets and the tank helmets hardly varied from the actual football helmets in terms of design. But it was the standard issue helmet that varied quite a bit. Millions of American servicemen wore that helmet in World War II, and it was called the M1. That didn't look like a football helmet because it didn't go all the way down over the ears or the back of the head, and they had two layers. It was an inner hard fiber shell and an outer non-magnetic steel shell. Inside the helmet, though, was the Riddell suspension system, same one used in their football helmets. 3.4 million M1 helmets with the Riddell suspension would be made for the war effort. In 1943, a new herringbone suspension system for the M1 helmets would be swapped out in the production process. Jerry Morgan, the designer who eventually ran the Riddell Company, told the Chicago Tribune in 1976, quote, "Every GI who went through training wore one. We gave the patent to the government for what I regret was a ridiculously low fee," end quote. Well, how kind of Mr. Morgan to not price gouge Uncle Sam. Riddell knew that he had a game-changing idea that might even help teams on their way to victory, but he had no idea that a victory would mean ending a world war. And unfortunately, John T. Riddell Sr. wouldn't get to see the full end of the war. He died on July 3, 1945, 2 months after the end of the war in Europe, but 6 weeks before Japan's unconditional surrender. Of all the ways we talk about how military borrows from football and football borrows from military, this example right here is the most consequential one. And of course, if the plastic helmet is good enough for the troops to go fight a war with, it's got to be good enough for football coaches and college programs to start buying up every plastic helmet they could find, right? Well, that's the problem. They were no longer easy to find or able to find at all because the government needed the plastics to produce all kinds of things in the war effort. So this whole arrival of the plastic helmet would have to wait for football, but obviously with good reason because it was going to help us win a war. But that wasn't the only thing from football that made its way into the war effort. There were plenty of other things, including the Supreme Allied Commander of Operation Torch, which was our first trip into battle in North Africa, Operation Avalanche, and Operation Overlord, which we know as D-Day. that Supreme Allied Commander of those operations was a guy named Dwight D. Eisenhower. You may recall me mentioning that Army coach in 1912 who pointed out the window and said, "There is my idea of football." Well, his starting halfback in 1912 was Dwight D. Eisenhower. And he was doing great, was going to go on to become a star football player had he not messed up by trying to tackle the greatest athlete of all time, Jim Thorpe. He tore his knee to shreds in that effort and had to take up other sports. But I guess it worked out because Eisenhower was a crucial part of success in Europe and that war. And an injury in 1912 didn't only affect Eisenhower. General George Patton was also set to play on that Army team at West Point in 1912. But he also got sidelined with injury, but did it before the season started. Poor guy had to take up fencing and ended up being good enough of an athlete to participate in the 1912 Olympics. So I guess it worked out for him, and eventually it worked out for both of these guys, huh? As football enters wartime, the plastic helmets were no longer available, and neither were the bulk of able-bodied athletic young men. They were entering the service. So some colleges suspended their programs while others tried to carry on. And another thing occurred that was the same thing that happened during World War I, which was that some of these military bases and pre-flight schools became college football programs themselves, playing in standard college conferences and still playing against standard college teams. The only thing is, these are very well-trained guys who are in great shape, and some of these schools were basically all-star teams. In fact, NCAA Division I football teams during the decade of 1940s, when you rank it by winning percentage, six of the top 10 teams in D1 football were pre-flight school teams or teams representing flight fields like Randolph Field, March Field, and Naval Air Station Norman. Notre Dame was the only top five winning percentage team that wasn't a military school in the 1940s. And it's worth noting that military teams played a lot less because they had to ship out and get a big job done. You know, kind of a big deal. For example, the best winning percentage belonged to Randolph Field. 12 games played, 0 losses. Whereas number 3, Notre Dame, played 97 games from 1940 to 1949 and only lost 9 times. 5 of those losses were to military teams, including twice to Army and twice to the Great Lakes Navy Station. Iowa pre-flight is a standout in the era of D1 football with military teams. Number 5 in winning percentage, 31 games played with a record of 26-5. Now, coaching might have a little bit to do with that. In 1942, they got a record of 7-3 under Coach Bernie Bierman, who was the coach of Minnesota during peacetime. It was in 1943 that this team turned into a breeding ground for the next generation of success in football. During that 1943 season, the Iowa pre-flight Seahawks went 9-1 under their head coach Don Farrow, who was usually Missouri's football coach. But it was his assistant coaches who made the difference. Jim Tatum, who went on to be a head coach at Maryland and win a national championship, and Bud Wilkinson, a man who would later become the head coach of the Oklahoma Sooners. And Bud Wilkinson is an interesting guy. Now, the guy went from being successful in his own sport to being successful on screen and in government. But before all that, he was in the Navy. Wilkinson would move on from pre-flight school because you had to go serve in the actual war, and he would do so on the USS Enterprise. The Enterprise was an aircraft carrier that was very crucial in World War II. The Enterprise was also one of the big heroes in the Battle of Midway until it got hit with a Japanese Zero, a kamikaze attack that forced the Enterprise to head back to port and get an overhaul in dry dock. But when it set sail in 1944 from Seattle, Lieutenant Bud Wilkinson would be on board as an officer of the hangar deck. The hangar deck is just below the top deck. It's where they store all of the planes for battle. And there's a large elevator that will bring planes up to the top deck from the hangar deck. The Enterprise would be involved in the battle for the Philippine Sea, the Battle of Leyte Gulf, Luzon, provide support for the Marines during the Battle of Iwo Jima, and take part in the Battle of Okinawa. But it was during that battle at Okinawa in May of 1945 that a kamikaze Japanese Zero, piloted by Lieutenant J.G. Sunsuke Tamiyasu, destroyed the elevator between the top deck and the flight deck. That direct hit killed 13 sailors on the Enterprise. and Bud Wilkinson himself said that had he been another 3 feet closer, he would have been the 14th fatality. Because of this direct kamikaze hit, the Enterprise would once again have to limp back to U.S. shores. In August of 1945, the Enterprise was just about ready to re-enter the war, but August of 1945, the first of two atomic bombs were dropped over Japan. And by September 2nd of 1945, Japan signed its unconditional surrender. The war was over, and Bud Wilkinson, like many others, would re-enter civilian life. And Wilkinson went to work for his father for a little bit, and this was a guy that really loved football, did great at the Iowa pre-flight school, and was actually a quarterback in 1937 on the college all-star team that played in the NFL all-star game, where it was college all-stars versus the defending NFL champions. He led his team as a quarterback to a victory over the Green Bay Packers. And surely football life would resume again, right? Well, it did in 1946 when the other assistant coach at Iowa pre-flight, Jim Tatum, gave Wilkinson a call and said, "Hey, I've got this new head coaching job at Oklahoma University. Would you like to come be an assistant?" And so he did. This duo hoped to duplicate the magic they had going during that 1943 Iowa pre-flight school's 9-1 season. Now, during that time at the Iowa pre-flight school, Tatum and Wilkinson were running something we know of by now, the T formation. And that T formation would be the foundation of what would make Oklahoma such a powerful program moving forward. But there was something else in the mix. Their first game on the schedule in 1946 was against Army. And Army had been national champions in 1943, 1944, and 1945. And part of the reason for that was the fact that it was wartime and Army, especially West Point and the cadets, had the best and most physically able and brightest young men able to play football. But the other thing is that, remember we talked about the plastic helmet didn't really catch on around 1941 because of plastic rationing that went toward the armed forces, and the fact that Riddell helmet manufacturing now became geared toward the war effort and for supplying helmets to the armed forces. Well, Army and West Point is the armed forces. For whatever reason, they had the connections to get plastic helmets for their football team. So while all these other teams that West Point, the Army football team, were playing in 43, 44, 45 were using the traditional leather helmets, the Army team, on top of everything else they had going for them, like Coach Red Blake and big talented players, they also had the plastic helmet. And before we give anybody fits here, yes, Oklahoma State fans, I did just call Army the championship team of 1945. Anyway, back to the T formation. This is a point where the T formation and the plastic helmet come together yet again. I'm going to read from a book called Then Bud Said to Barry, Who Told Bob, The Best Oklahoma Sooner Stories Ever Told, by Jeff Snook. Quote, "Remember that back in the 1940s, Army and its pair of Heisman Trophy winners, Felix Doc Blanchard and Glenn Davis, were the talk of college football. The cadets had the best of everything, especially when it came to reputation, publicity, and even equipment. Before the Sooners' 1946 season opening game at Army, keeping up with the Joneses took on a whole new meaning. Jim Tatum had just been hired by Oklahoma President George Lynn Cross and the Board of Regents, and suddenly the new coach had recruited dozens of talented players to Norman. Tatum and offensive coordinator Bud Wilkinson had introduced the new talent to the split T formation, the run-oriented offense featuring the option. Nobody in 1946 had the slightest idea that this new offense of Oklahoma's would give his opponents fits for the next 18 seasons, as the university would build the greatest dynasty the game has ever seen. But first things first, Tatum wanted his new team to look as good as the best teams in the country. We'd practiced in those old leather helmets," quarterback Jack Mitchell recalled, "and everybody knew that Army wore those modern Riddell helmets. Well, Tatum made up his mind that he would order the Riddell helmets for the entire team. He told us that we would have helmets just like the Army team. They were much better helmets that offered you more protection. And once word got out on those helmets, that's all anyone talked about. We kept after our equipment man, Sarge Dempsey, always asking, 'Sarge, when are those helmets coming in? When are those helmets coming in?'" Mitchell recalled that one day Tatum was nowhere to be found at the beginning of practice, when suddenly a big truck was seen heading toward the practice field. "Guess who was sitting on the top of that truck?" Mitchell asked. "That's right, Tatum," He was sitting up there going through those helmets as the truck came down the road. He then tossed all those helmets out for us, and all of the big old linemen got up there first and got theirs. Finally, I got mine, and it was so big, by the end of practice, it had pivoted around and slid down and cut my nose. I still have a scar there. I walked up to Sarge and said, "My helmet's too big for my head." Tatum, standing there at the time, he said, "No, Jack, hell, there's nothing wrong with that helmet. That's just the helmet Davis and Blanchard wear." I guess he didn't care about the size of it, but I'll bet Davis's and Blanchard's fit their heads. End quote. So here you have another case where players are excited about the helmet and all the benefits it provides. The more protection, the ability to run complicated things like the tee, and also, it gets hot in Oklahoma toward the end of summer. So when you're practicing in these leather helmets, it gets a little bit toasty. Now you're wearing something that's lighter and also has a bit more ventilation. Like I've already said multiple times, this will come down to not just one factor, like having a plastic helmet that virtually no other team has the power of, but the combination of multiple factors. They have an advantage of a powerful and punishing yet protective plastic helmet, but the Sooners have a roster of big and talented players and a duo of coaches with a heck of a lot of talent as well. And that talent and that helmet paid off pretty much right away. That 1946 season, they dropped their season opener at West Point 21-7, but went on to get an 8-3 record. On defense, they were second in the nation, giving up an average of only 141.7 yards per game. Their rushing defense was even better, ranked number one in the nation, and gave up an average of only 58 rushing yards per game. The AP ranked them as number 14 by the end of that season, and even though their record was 8-3, they were 4-1 within their conference, the Big Six Conference. And so, they were co-champions of the Big Six that year, and also went to the Gator Bowl to take on NC State and won that one 34-13. And that season was so successful that Maryland gave Jim Tatum a call. Must have given him a great offer in order to entice him to leave after just a year with Oklahoma, but Tatum did leave. And Oklahoma turned to Bud Wilkinson and said, "Well, do you want to be the head coach?" And he said, "Sure." And what a great idea that was. If you've ever played football, ever practiced football, Wilkinson becoming head coach of the Oklahoma Sooners affected you. Here's how. We already know about the plastic helmets coming into play, pushing the limits of what players could do and the limits of what plays coaches could use. When it comes to the plastic helmet, they saw it as an advantage in one way or another. Multiple ways, really. Now, Wilkinson was already running the T formation and had been coaching that since before he went off to war on the Enterprise. And so many other football programs were now starting to use the T formation because it was so wildly successful with Stanford and the Chicago Bears. And while teams were figuring out how to run the T formation, teams were still figuring out how to defend against it because we were still in this transition going from the era of the single wing offense into the T formation offense, but the defensive end was still defending as if they were playing against a single wing offense and hoping they just happened to make it work out to defend against the T. Wilkinson knew that things had to adapt, evolve, or you end up losing. So he was trying to devise a way to specifically defend against the versatility of the T formation. And what he came up with was something called the Okie front. Instead of having six linebackers all bunched up at the line of scrimmage ready to stop the running game, he thought, well, maybe if I spread these guys out, make them more efficient, I can take one of those players off of the line of scrimmage, put them in the backfield, and have a more efficient, more versatile defense that can defend against all the options being run within the T formation. That was the Okie front. But here's the catch. When you don't have a mass of players doing all the blocking together in unison, well, then all of your tacklers and blockers at the line had better be great one-on-one because they need to be more efficient individually since they won't be just working as a whole and massing together. That's a big ask. Here's an article from ESPN, the magazine's August 18th, 2015 issue, written by David Fleming. Quote, Wilkinson had served in the Navy's V-5 pre-flight program, which trained and evaluated cadets for aviation and used boxing and wrestling as tools to weed out pilots who lacked the competitiveness and aggression for warfare. With World War II over and the GI Bill still in effect, Oklahoma's campus and football tryouts were flooded with former soldiers. Wilkinson realized he, too, needed a way to assess the fighting will of hundreds of potential players. Wilkinson also wanted something that would train his players for his new defense. Most teams at the time were using the wide tackle six, a heavy human barricade style front, but Wilkinson had developed a way to add speed, athleticism, and creativity by positioning his outside linebackers on the line as defensive ends. This was the 5-2 Okie front, known today as the 3-4 defense. To make it work, Wilkinson needed three interior down linemen who could do the work of four or more by exploding off the snap, reading the ball carrier, and then, in tight quarters, shedding blocks to make tackles. In other words, he needed players who could excel at the Oklahoma drill. We called it one-on-one, and oh, I couldn't begin to count the number of times Bud made us run that drill, says Jack Santee, member of the Sooners' first national championship team in 1950. It was a competitive-spirited thing, and it's the very foundation of what we built at Oklahoma. End quote. And there you have it, the origin of the Oklahoma drill. A test of strength for each player, and also a test of that hard plastic helmet on their head. And as we move on, we're going to see that coaches start to tell players to actually use their helmets in these situations. They'd say, put the top of your head right toward your opponent's chin. Wilkinson's first season as a head coach in 1947 was a pretty good one. 7-2-1 the overall record, undefeated in the conference with a 4-0-1 record. They won a conference title that year, and the year after, and the year after, and the year after, and the year after, and the year after. Look, all right, from 1947 to 1959, he won a conference title or better with the Oklahoma Sooners. In 1950, 55, and 56, those were national championship years, sporting records of 10-1, 11-0, and 10-0. The more you look at the details, the more clearly dominant Wilkinson and the Sooners were. From 1947 to 1959, they played 77 conference games. And the record among those 77 conference games, 74 wins, one loss, and two ties. And that one loss within the conference was in 1959. 11 seasons without a single loss in the conference. If you were looking for a team to define dynasty, this is it. He had three appearances in the Sugar Bowl from 1948 to 1950, won two of them, dropped one of them, and appeared in the Orange Bowl five times. Four wins, one loss in 1962. The guy was an incredible coach. And when you listen actually to some of the accounts of Wilkinson, even though the Oklahoma drill is a brutal drill, apparently he was very good with his players, very supportive, and was also one of the rare coaches at the time who believed in not working over players, not punishing them. As long as they knew their drills and as long as they were working hard, there was no need to overwork them. And what player doesn't love that? But as I mentioned a little bit ago, this guy is one of those overachievers. He just has it all. If you look on YouTube, he actually did some local access shows teaching people about the ins and outs of football in the 1950s in Oklahoma. And even then, just watching him talk, like, he's just a handsome, charming, good-looking guy who you just want to watch and pay attention to. And that's why he was so good as a broadcaster with ABC Sports, a job that he took up in 1965. And I also mentioned he was part of politics in a presidential cabinet. Yeah, he was on President John F. Kennedy's President's Council of Physical Fitness from 1961 to 1964. That's the same job Arnold Schwarzenegger held during George H.W.'s presidency. And in 1964, he didn't run for governor of California, but he did run for senator of Oklahoma. He won the primary and just narrowly lost to Democrat Fred R. Harris in that 1964 election. When you think about the prototype of the American dream, Bud Wilkinson fits the bill. He's one of two people I can think of who fit that bill. Wilkinson served in the Navy, helped win a war, becomes one of the most dominant people in the history of his sport, is gifted with on-camera charm, gets involved in politics, becomes a star of the screen. Sounds a lot like the life and career of Arnold Schwarzenegger, too. Come on, Sooners! It's time to do the Oklahoma drill! Put on this plastic helmet if you want to live. Come on, Oklahoma! Get to the Sooner schooner! Come on! Go! And props to Bud Wilkinson. He's a great innovator of the game. He used new ways of playing the game, combined that with new types of gear. He's the reason why we have the Oklahoma drill that, let's face it, wouldn't be what it is without the plastic helmet. And Oklahoma wasn't the only team using a plastic helmet in 1946. Notre Dame took those on. In 1946, they were under head coach Frank Leahy, and maybe the helmets helped out their size and skill and recruiting abilities as well, as in 1946, Notre Dame had an 8-0-1 record, and 47 had a 9-0 record, and 48, 9-0-1, 1949 was 10-0. But that was a pretty dominant program at the time. Another good team, but very talented and brilliant coach, eager to get his hands on the advantage that the plastic helmet provides, was Bear Bryant. No, I'm not about to say Alabama. He was at Kentucky in 1946. Bear Bryant is a coach known for his rough and tumble brand of football, so the plastic helmet makes sense. It's a helmet that can help players accommodate that style. And that season, he compiled a 7-3 record and outscored opponents by 233-90. But his abilities, the new players he took on, and the new equipment he took on flipped around that program pretty quickly. The year prior, they had gone 2-8. Before that, 3-6. And in 1942, they had gone 3-6-1. But it was a good thing for Kentucky to finally have a good football team and a great coach, because this was known as a basketball school. And that has always been the tug of war. That's been a narrative that happened lately. It even caused a rift between John Calipari and Mark Stoops, who are the current coaches of the basketball and football program. And there was a rift between Bear Bryant and Adolph Rupp back in the day as well. And in 1950, when Bear Bryant's football team goes 11-1, wins the SEC title, and wins the Sugar Bowl, well, maybe that would cement Kentucky as now a football school over a basketball school, right? Well, no, because also that same year, Kentucky's basketball team won a championship. But what a great situation for Kentucky. They have a football team that won a conference title, won the Sugar Bowl. You have a basketball team who is NCAA champions and went 14-0 in their conference. So, is it a basketball school or a football school? Well, at the end of the year, the coaches got gifts for winning championships. Adolph Rupp got a new Cadillac. Bear Bryant got an engraved Zippo lighter. Bear Bryant stuck around for a couple more years, but after that little debacle, he knew he had to get out of there. He wanted to go to a school where football was king. And he was so desperate to leave that he went to some all-boys school down in Texas. It was known as Texas A&M. Vanderbilt also wears a plastic helmet in 1946. And same back then as it is today, that's about all I can say about Vanderbilt. Another story about a team using a plastic helmet in 1946 comes from Holy Cross University. The 1945 season had been good for Holy Cross University. They earned a trip to their first ever Orange Bowl, and they were going to be playing against the Miami Hurricanes, basically a home game for Miami. But the day before a game, the Associated Press circulated an article about a new piece of headwear that Holy Cross was trying to get a hold of. Yeah, you know what it is, it's the plastic helmet. The headline of this article said, Holy Cross to wear plastic helmets. It said, quote, the Crusaders will be bedecked in plastic helmets courtesy of Allentown High School because of the extreme heat in Florida. Well, the weather was forecasted to be mid-70s, not necessarily extreme heat, but they were trying to use that as their story, because plastic helmets, like I had said, with that suspension and the plastic shell, did provide a little bit better ventilation, or at least some airflow over the head. But I don't know, I'm skeptical of this one. Either way, the article states that Alvin Doggy Julian, who was one of the assistant coaches at Holy Cross, used to be the head football coach at Allentown. So he called his former team and said, hey, you know those plastic helmets we were using? Can you let us borrow those? And so according to the article, quote, the helmets went special delivery to Miami, end quote. It's just interesting to read that the plastic helmet makes so much of a difference that a coach is willing to call a high school and have them overnight helmets just in time for this one game. Do they really work? Well, the article ends with this, quote, for the past 2 years, ever since the helmets were introduced, Allentown's football team hasn't lost a conference game and has been beaten only once, end quote. So the helmets were making a difference for Allentown, and now Allentown High School was going to pack up those helmets, send them down to Florida so that Holy Cross could use them on this big day, New Year's Day 1946, for the Orange Bowl game against Miami. And what an interesting game that was. Holy Cross, maybe they were underdogs in this game, but we would definitely think of them as underdogs now. With 15 seconds left on the clock in the fourth, the game tied at 6, Holy Cross has the ball, and they are 11 yards away from the goal line. It could have ended in a tie, but the rookie coach, John Ox DeGrosa, wanted that win. He called for the passing play, and that pass glanced off of the receiver's fingertips and ended up in the hands of a Miami defender who ran it back 89 yards for the go-ahead touchdown right as time expired. The final score was 13-6, Miami over Holy Cross. Holy Cross has yet to appear in a bowl game since. So is the plastic helmet the reason why they at least got close to a tie or victory? 11 yards, one tipped pass away from winning a bowl game, their first ever, their last ever. Well, the thing is, when I looked this up, I thought it was an interesting story that they were trying to overnight these plastic helmets, and the coach really wanted them because they thought it could help in one way or another. I still don't buy this weather and heat story. There's more to it than that. Come on. But when I looked up pictures of the game that day, I don't see plastic helmets on the heads of Holy Cross. It looks like either those helmets didn't make it on time, or they just didn't fit the players that they were intended for. And when it comes down to 15 seconds left in the game, 11 yards shy of the end zone, would a plastic helmet have made the difference and gotten Holy Cross that win? There's no telling. There's too many variables. The game is chaos. So Holy Cross tried to get their plastic helmet. Didn't exactly work out. There was a handful of teams, but not many, using plastic helmets in 1946, but pretty much all of them were successful in one way or another. And there's one other team in 1946 that joins the elite company of those handful of programs using a plastic helmet. It's a school that nobody really knows of, in a part of the country that nobody ever really goes to, and I'm not going to get into that right now. Listen to next episode, because that is a story all in its own. So go ahead and subscribe to the podcast if you haven't yet, so you know when that episode comes out. It's an interesting story. There's more after a quick break. So with the plastic helmet finding success with a handful of programs, word starts to get out. When something does well, everybody else wants to see if they can find an advantage in it too. In 1947, even the Eastman Plastic Company, who makes the Tenite plastics for the Riddell helmets, was putting out ads that said things like this, quote, "Whether you're cheering for Army, Navy, or Notre Dame, this fall you'll find players on all three teams wearing helmets of tough Tenite plastic. Considerably lighter than most leather ones, the Tenite helmets are extremely strong and resilient, with no head injury reported in 7 years of use." There's no sources cited on that claim. "The player's head fits into a shock-absorbent webbing, which eliminates direct contact with the headgear. The relatively flat crown reduces risk of injury to an opponent. The new Tenite helmets are designed somewhat larger than leather headgear, hence are cooler, better ventilated, and provide better hearing. The two halves of the helmet are economically molded, then assembled by cementing and riveting. Molded transparent, they are sprayed inside with school colors. The smooth, moisture-resistant Tenite surfaces are easy to clean and can be kept bright and new-looking for years. If your plans call for a lighter, safer, and more economical product, it will pay you to investigate the many advantages of versatile Tenite. Chances are you will find just the combination of properties you need and increase sales, too." End quote. Reaching out to the sporting goods profession and making sure that Tenite ends up on shelves. And more teams are starting to take on these helmets because, again, it provides a lot of benefits. Better protection for players. There's that compensatory behavior effect that comes in, giving players more confidence, less fear of injury. And there's less maintenance, less expenses. You don't have to send the helmets away to get refurbished every season. You don't have to sew up rips and tears. There's no mold and mildew, and they don't gain weight throughout the course of a game. And while advertising is increasing and sales are increasing for the plastic helmet, its use is becoming more widespread. Well, in turn, criticism becomes more widespread as well. In the October 29th, 1946 edition of the New York Times, Arthur Daly, Sports writer had his usual column, Sports of the Times, Conversation and Vitamins, Just a Tea Party, and a Touch of Claustrophobia. And in this column, he recalls the meeting up of some really influential football people at a New York pub called Toots Shores Grub Emporium. And he's really just recounting all the conversations that he overheard as he milled about the room. For example, people congratulating the coach of the Giants, who was celebrating a win over the Chicago Bears the day before. Stout Steve Owen, he said, didn't have to pick up the check that day and received praises like, quote, "Your line was great," said Lou Little. "But not enough credit has been given to your backers up. They did a marvelous job too," end quote. But the interesting part comes a little bit later in the column in a section labeled Just a Tea Party, alluding to the tea formation. Quote, "Your Excellency," said Laval to McKeever with mock reverence, "why don't you abandon the tea formation in favor of the single wing? I've learned one thing about the tea," remarked Owen. "Most of the tea teams murder you if you use a 5-3 defense, but they don't yet know how to get set against a 5-4. "That's right," countered the always helpful Laval. "They need an extra arm for what they laughably call a brush block. I tell you, the main trouble with that tee is you wind up with too many guys grabbing the same pair of legs." "We kept our men low, Lou," replied Owen, "and they couldn't wheel out on us." "I like my men just high enough," said Little, "so that they drill their helmets into the other fellow's face, if he's foolish enough to keep it there." "Something should be done about those plastic helmets," said Reach Red Smith emphatically. "Some are as hard as steel." "What about the casts some linemen put on their arms?" chirped the cheerful Lavelle, a merry gleam in his eyes. "Do you think all of them are there merely for medical purposes?" End quote. Just an interesting peer into these conversations just happening at a bar after the games of the week. But that conversation sticks out, and I'm sharing it with you because not only are they talking about the T formation and the various uses of it, but they're talking about uses of helmets within the T formation. Coaches saying that they want their guys to drill their helmet into the other guy's face, which instantly gets the reply of something's got to be done about those plastic helmets. So it seems like there's a correlation there. Again, this article came out toward the end of 1946. In 1947, Dr. George Bennett, specialist surgeon at Johns Hopkins, speaks out against plastic helmets and about some of these steel face masks that are coming into play. We'll talk about face masks in another episode. He published his viewpoints through the Associated Press that circulated in newspapers nationwide with headlines like, "Football Uniforms Exacting Injuries." The article said, quote, "Dr. George Bennett, one of the busiest surgeons in the country patching up star athletes, came out today in favor of less work for himself by urging legislation against football equipment, which dresses players in uniforms as rugged as the coats of mail worn by knights of old. The focal point of his objections is the football helmet." This is a quote from Dr. George Bennett. Quote, "The present helmet is simply equipping a player with armor, and the steel face mask in front is an open invitation to crush someone's jaw or knock his teeth out." That's the end of Bennett's quote, but the article goes on. "This is almost a whole year's quota of words for the Johns Hopkins specialist. It is more than has ever been said about his work on such sports figures as Joe DiMaggio, Pete Reiser, and others. Usually he just says, operation successful. He has a lot more words to say about football uniforms." Here is another quote from Dr. Bennett. "The toll of injuries will continue to mount," he declares, "unless it is legislated out of the game immediately." He also suggests it's time to start making helmets out of soft leather instead of these hard plastics. The surgeon puts the blame squarely on the rock-hard helmet for a whole evolution of dangerous equipment. Instead of serving as a protection against head injury and shock, now it serves as an offensive piece of armor," he declared. "In order to protect himself against the jar and injury of his helmet, the underneath equipment has been toughened and increased until every player goes on the field covered with armor, all of it carrying potential injury on every play. An opposing player cannot come into contact with that kind of equipment without leaving himself open to serious injury. That's wrong. Fortunately, a boy doesn't often get struck in a vital spot, but he gets a jar, which is not part of the game of football, and too many get hurt." End quote. As criticism for the plastic helmet continues to grow, so does the use of the plastic helmet. Coaches see a benefit in it. Players see a benefit in it. And one coach who has seen a benefit in it since day one is Clark Shaughnessy. In 1947, he joins the Los Angeles Rams as an advisor. And with that, he starts recommending a couple of players start using this plastic helmet, one of them being Fred Nomitz. And during that 1947 season, I don't know what he was doing with that helmet or how he was using it, but whatever he was doing caused at least 9 plastic helmets to break or shatter while he was wearing them. And he wasn't the only one breaking helmets. He was just doing it enough to where he's the guy that's cited for the reason why the NFL decides to ban plastic helmets for the 1948 season. This tinite plastic, the way it was, just wasn't ready to hold up to some of the biggest and strongest football players grinding it out play after play. So it looks like the days of the plastic helmet might be over, at least in the National Football League. But during this prohibition of the plastic helmet in 1948, something new came to the helmets from that point forward. Let me tell you about a guy named Fred Gehrke. Gehrke has a lot in common with another helmet innovator, a guy named Robert Zupke. They both innovated helmets, and they were both talented artists and illustrators. Zupke came up with the Zupke helmet, the suspension design with the leather helmet that increased protection substantially in his day. And Gehrke would redesign helmets in a different way, by putting his artistic talents to use. Zupke used to paint landscape scenes whenever he traveled, whether it was in Cuba, Colorado, or the American Southwest. Now, I don't know what Gehrke painted in his own time or out of his own interest, but he was an art major at the University of Utah, and because of a previous knee surgery, thanks to, I think, football, he wasn't able to join the armed forces during World War II. So he joined the war effort by going to work at the Northrop Corporation, what we now know as Northrop Grumman. They make the B-2 bomber and other aircraft for the U.S. military. Gehrke would be a technical illustrator, basically drawing up plans, designs, schematics, blueprints, whatever you want to call it. He was on the design team for the P-61. Nicknamed the Black Widow, it was a twin-boom, twin-engine design meant to be a nighttime fighter and would be in service from 1944 until 1954. But now with the Los Angeles Rams, he wanted to put his creativity back into his job. So he came up with an idea and went to the team staff and pitched this idea for a design on the helmet that he would paint. Well, they ran that idea up the flagpole, he got his approval, and they said, "We will pay you $1 per helmet to do this design." And in today's money, that $1 would be $12.37. The design that he came up with, well, he painted the helmet in solid blue and then with yellow, painted ram horns on either side of the helmet. And that created the iconic LA Rams horns that have been on Rams helmets no matter whether they're in LA or St. Louis. And it is integrated into the DNA of the LA Rams logo to this very day. It was such a hit with fans that other teams decided to explore painting and designing their helmets, and now every team has some sort of helmet design, and it's something we look to as an icon whenever we look at football. Much like Michigan's winged helmet design. In fact, the colors are pretty similar too. But as I just alluded to, when it's a leather helmet, well, the paint moves and flakes off because the leather helmet is flexible, and poor Fred Gehrke was having to repaint these things week after week after week. And that is a lot of work, especially for $1 a helmet. But lucky for him, there was some work going on behind the scenes that would hopefully help reduce the amount of work he was having to do during the Great Prohibition of 1948. Number one was that Riddell was revising the types of synthetics and chemicals they were using to make the helmet. They want it to protect players. They want it to be rigid. They want to make a good product that will make the game safer. Number two, in 1948, Dr. Morris Fishbein, head of the Journal of the American Medical Association, made his case that football is no more dangerous for boys than basketball or baseball. He gives football the American Medical Association seal of approval, a decision that was controversial among the ranks of the American Medical Association, mind you. He stated that plastic helmets make the game incredibly safe. Sports equipment manufacturers, understandably, would leap all over that. But here's the deal with Dr. Fishbein and the way that he ran the Journal of the American Medical Association. He was based out of a Chicago office, and Dr. Fishbein himself didn't have extensive experience as a practicing medical doctor. And on more than one occasion during his time as the head of that journal for the American Medical Association, as well as being a syndicated columnist as a doctor, he's landed in hot water for pay-to-play operations. Have you heard of the medical company Abbott Industries? They make medicine, baby formula, all kinds of stuff. Well, in the early 1900s, Mr. Abbott himself launched a campaign against Dr. Fishbein and his journal, saying that they were allegedly blackmailed. "Pay us for your product or you won't get our blessing." basically. And of course, he has a lot of sway in doing so because the American Medical Association has big ties everywhere, and he also has a syndicated column in places like Reader's Digest. One of the biggest medical ruses from Dr. Fishbein's career was with cigarettes. He helped tobacco companies skew tests to have positive results. And that led us to that era where doctors were recommending cigarette brands. You had doctors appearing on screen smoking a cigarette and saying, "This is the one that I recommend for you to have a healthy throat." And as the American Medical Association's journal was publishing their approval of cigarettes, backed by Dr. Fishbein, they also had ads for cigarettes. And those cigarette companies, when they were sending their checks to be in the journal, well, they were sending them straight to Dr. Fishbein. Does that sound like pay-to-play to you? He wasn't a favorite among the American Medical Association, especially when it came to that tobacco approval. So in 1949, he was forced out of that position, and the journal almost immediately published a study about the harmful effects of smoking cigarettes. And as that study was being published in the newly revised Journal of the American Medical Association, well, Dr. Fishbein, he wasn't out of the job long. He took a job with the tobacco lobby. So, given what we know, I'm just going to say here that in 1948, the plastic helmet and football gets a seal of approval. And also there's the fact that Dr. Fishbein has his offices in Chicago and that Dr. Fishbein is friends with George Halas, owner of the Chicago Bears, coach of the Chicago Bears, friend or at least business associate with John T. Riddell, who has a direct stake in the well-being of football and the existence of the plastic helmet. I am not saying anything directly here. All I'm doing is providing you some context here so that you can make your own decision. But either way, this 1948 American Medical Association approval of football and citing the plastic helmet as the reason why it's safe, well, it had an influence when the plastic helmet was at a crossroads in football, not just during the ban from the NFL, but also when the plastic helmet was under extreme scrutiny and facing a ban in college football. In 1948, Harvard player Ken O'Donnell suffered a broken ankle, and they blamed it on the plastic helmet. Harvard Athletic Director William Bingham, who was head of the Football Rules Committee, advised Harvard and helmet manufacturers that helmets were going to be banned by 1950. They were sick of seeing injuries as a result of the use of the plastic helmet. He'd already asked manufacturers to stop making these hard plastic helmets prior to the 1948 season because of the danger they posed, saying in newspapers, quote, "When our committee meets again in January, I'm going to remind the manufacturers that the plastic helmets will not be permitted in the 1950 season. All of the makers will have had time to dispose of all such stock by then," end quote. That would not happen. At the NCAA meeting in January of 1949, Chairman Lou Little received 700 replies from the 1,000 questionnaires they sent out about the helmets. That survey indicated that most wanted further study on the perfection of the protection equipment. They believed that the plastic helmets provided better protection than leather and that the way to make the game safer, at least the path to do so, required going down the path of further exploration of the plastic helmet rather than a ban of these plastic helmets. One influential person in college football had already been coming to the defense of plastic helmets, an early adopter of the plastic helmet who knew it was helping his team on the field, Bud Wilkinson. In the November 12, 1948 edition of the Daily Oklahoman, he was quoted as saying this about the helmet, quote, "We have been using them for 3 years and haven't had a single head injury. Head injuries are the most serious in football, and plastic helmets have reduced them remarkably. I would rather see a minor injury in a plastic helmet than the concussions boys who wore the old helmets used to get. I have never seen a head injury in either practice or a game to teams using the plastic helmets," end quote. So that effort to get the plastic helmets banned did not take hold, and right around the time that this lobbying was taking place for getting rid of the plastic helmets was right around the same time that these articles were coming out saying that football has the American Medical Association seal of approval and that so do the plastic helmets. Also, while this was going on in 1949, George Halas was doing some lobbying of his own among the NFL, saying that the plastic helmets needed to come back, that they were improved, that we can make them even better, and that it is the perfect thing to grow the game and protect all of the players that are playing in the National Football League. So in 1949, the plastic helmet would come back to the NFL. Helmets were made mandatory in the NFL in 1943. Players who didn't wear a helmet before 1943 didn't have to start wearing one, but any player entering the league thereafter had to wear one. Going into the 1949 season, most players had their pick of whether they wanted to use leather or plastic. But the head coach of the LA Rams definitely wanted plastic helmets for his team. And the head coach's name? Clark Shaughnessy. Entering his second year as head coach of the LA Rams, he had joined the team in 1948 as an advisor, but the team's owner was so impressed by this guy during the preseason, he fired the head coach and placed Shaughnessy in that position. And I guess Shaughnessy thought, you know what, I want to redesign the uniforms altogether. Instead of the colors being blue and yellow, their colors matched the other team that was playing at the LA Coliseum, USC Trojans. In 1949, the Rams had the colors of maroon and yellow, with the helmets being that solid maroon and yellow horns that had the texture of ram horns, too. And lucky for Fred Gehrke, because these were plastic helmets, he only had to paint the solid maroon background and the textured ram horns one time instead of multiple times, a bigger bang for his buck at $1 a helmet. And during this season, well, that would be the first time that the Associates, who revolutionized the game of football through not just the use of the helmet, but the T formation and the modernization of it, would have to face off against one another. Twice, Clark Shaughnessy and George Halas went head-to-head for the first time on October 9th of 1949 at Wrigley Field. The Bears would fall to the Rams 31-16, but Halas would have his rematch later that month, October 30th, at the LA Memorial Coliseum. It was a record-breaking crowd that day on October 30th, 86,000 people showing up to see this big matchup against the two. And the game was so good, it went late into the day and even after sundown. And that's when things get interesting. Because you know these two, Shaughnessy and Halas, they're looking for advantages wherever they can find them, whether it's in the playbook, the equipment his players are wearing, or something within the stadium. Well, on this particular night, after the sun goes down, well, those 86,000 fans, that record-breaking crowd, can't even see the game. The game was being played in the dark. Here's a quote from one of the recap articles in the Los Angeles Times, written by Dick Hyland. Quote, "One mysterious item never quite solved, who kept the lights turned off long after dusk, obscured the players from the record-breaking crowd. The officials asked both captains after every play, and both kept saying no lights. The Bears finally tried to take advantage of the darkness by hiding out a player on a dimly seen sideline of the field. Even Bear quarterback Lou Jack missed him and fired a pass to a covered teammate on the opposite side of the field. Coliseum manager Bill Nicholas says he got word from the Rams to leave the lights off. It was impossible to trace the culprit down further than the trio of owner Dan Reeves, manager Bill Johns, and coach Clark Shaughnessy. Shaughnessy says he said he didn't care whether they were on or not. Nicholas finally turned them on his own initiative just before the last play of the game. Bear coach George Halas will undoubtedly have a great deal more to say than his mumbling following the game yesterday once he views his motion pictures. They, however, are most likely to be on the blurred side even though the cameraman was using fast film. It was that dark when the game was finished." End quote. Great that someone took the initiative to turn the stadium lights on for the last play, but it was the play before the last play, conveniently, that had the most consequence. See, the Bears were winning 24-20, and the Rams were making their push to try and take the lead. A pass goes into the end zone, into the darkness, and a referee who's probably having a hard time seeing all of this and making the right calls, well, he calls pass interference, saying that a Bears player pushed a Rams player out of bounds and prevented him from being able to catch the ball. And that put the ball on the Bears' one-yard line. The lights come on, and that allows Cowig of the Rams to easily punch into the end zone for that one-yard gain and leads them to what ends up being a 27-24 victory. I'd say the darkness provided at least a little bit of an advantage, right? And isn't it just poetic that a game between two guys who are always looking for an advantage, even if it's a little bit sneaky and a little bit questionable, well, at least it's an advantage found, right? Shaughnessy would be relieved of his duties as head coach by the end of that season, so he only coached for the 1949 and 1948 season. In 1951, he would go back to the Chicago Bears to work with George Halas for another 11 years. Halas and Shaughnessy innovated the game by using the inventiveness of John T. Riddell in his plastic helmet and by introducing the modernized T formation. The September 5th, 1977 edition of Sports Illustrated cited a study from Football Digest saying that by the end of the 1940s, of the 350 top college teams in the country, 250 were using the T. And as all these teams were taking on the T formation, they were also switching to the plastic helmet, because this better equips players to play in the style required for that T formation. And with that, football lived happily ever after. No player was ever injured again, and every team won every game. Yeah, of course, that's not what happened. The game did get better, it evolved, it got stronger and faster, and the helmets did provide more protection. But with everybody getting more protection, that becomes the new baseline. That's how evolution works. You set a new bar, equip everybody to meet that bar, and things start to evolve all over again. It's the circle of life! So injuries start to mount up yet again as we get toward the middle and end of the 1950s, and the injuries are occurring at an alarming rate, as are the fatalities. And the critics start to speak up, and the debates about the cause of the injuries and how to fix them start to fire up yet again. And at the center of the debate is the plastic helmet and the T formation. And in the Cedar Rapids Gazette, an article by Frank Nye headlined "Hawk Physician Defends Use of Plastic Helmets," it says, quote, "We may be seeing more head and neck injuries because of the T formation with its check blocking, in which players have to use their arms and elbows. Players are also taught to use their heads for ramrods in the T formation rather than using their shoulders for blocking." End quote. But the two could possibly go hand in hand, right? Would players be using their heads as ramrods if they were still using old flimsy leather helmets? The inventiveness and innovations of John T. Riddell, Clark Shaughnessy, and George Halas really did change the way the game was played, change the way it looked. And as the football ecosystem adapts those changes and those innovations, well, it's going to bring about the need for even more change, more adaptation, more protection for players in this new era of football. So, let's recap the past couple of episodes right up to now. Right as sales were about to take off in 1941, the war happened and production pivoted. The helmet designed for football would be tweaked in design to be ready to fight in the war. So the helmet went to the front lines by way of air, land, ships, and tanks. It was donned by the Army football team during the war and adopted by just a handful of teams that year after the war. These handful of teams using the helmet boosted the popularity by winning with them. Any team that went up against these helmets felt their true power, wore ice packs because of that power, and knew they had to outfit their teams with that power too. Adapt or be destroyed. But again, just as sales were taking off, the existence of the plastic helmet was again under threat. Banned in the NFL and under threat of ban in the NCAA. But as we know, this hard plastic helmet is resilient. It survived the bans, and by the early 1950s, they were being used just about everywhere. Toward the end of the 1950s, leather helmets were hardly even being made at all. The game was changing as a ripple effect from this new helmet. And as we've already heard a little bit in this episode, a big part of that change was blocking and tackling. And as we learned in the first episode of this series, blocking and tackling is the most key part of playing football. Vince Lombardi himself has even said, quote, 90% of offensive football is blocking, end quote. The way that players tackle and block changed with this new helmet that allowed them to tackle and block with their head in ways that would have gotten them really hurt in a leather helmet. Players on the line of scrimmage were being told to drive the forehead or the top of the head at the face of their opponents at the snap of the ball. Some articles compared this technique to battering rams. Players started to utilize the head in tackles more often than not as well, and this led to an increase in facial injuries and more. And that led to change brought on by necessity, and that big change is the face mask. Next episode, we'll talk about a couple of players who figured out how to fully utilize the power of the plastic helmet. Remember earlier when I mentioned one small team in 1946 that was one of a handful of teams to get a plastic helmet that year? Yeah, well, on that team, it would really affect one particular player. We'll talk about him next episode, as well as a small man who played big at Baylor, and how football entered a new era once the power of the plastic helmet gets combined with the face mask. Night trains, neckties, butt blocks, and bite the ball football. That's next episode of How Gear Changed the Game. Thanks for listening to How Gear Changed the Game. If you haven't yet, go ahead and subscribe to the podcast. That'll let you know when other episodes come out. And also, subscribing to this show really is a big help in our efforts here. How Gear Changed the Game is an exploration of the interesting stories involved with the evolution of a game and the evolution of a gear and the role that those two have on one another, the effect that those two have on one another. I'm simply going through the pages of history and finding the interesting stories and sharing them with you. I'm not trying to make any sort of political case, and I understand that football helmets in particular is politically charged. And I'm not trying to put any kind of horse in that race. I'm simply finding some interesting stories, trying to back them up with facts, and share them with all of you in an interesting manner, because this stuff is fascinating to me. My name is Alex Kindig Sherman. I am the executive producer, host, researcher, writer, and housekeeper of How Gear Changed the Game. We're going to be covering all kinds of gear in all kinds of sports. So if you have any suggestions for a future episode of How Gear Changed the Game, you can email me. How Gear Changed the Game at gmail.com.